Before we begin, I'd like to welcome the progenitor of our series, the woman who started it all. This is our 11th year. It really wouldn't have happened without her. She's in the house. It's a very special occasion for us. So please join me in welcoming back to What Matters to Me and Why, Rabbi Susan Lemley, Dean Emeritus of Religious Life. Thank you, Susan. I also want to acknowledge that this has been a tough week for a lot of us. I know it's been traumatic for me. I know a lot of us are wrestling very deeply with the news of Kim Kardashian's divorce. So I just want you all to know that you should have faith and love. Don't let this make you cynical. And chaplains are available for you if you need them. So as you know, one of the great things about our series is that it's student-run, student-produced. We have a wonderful speaker today. To introduce our speaker, please join me in welcoming one of the members of our student committee, Benjamin So.
Well, hi. I'm sad about Kim, too, so it's okay. Who here has watched the movie Avatar or heard of the movie Avatar? Okay, awesome. So Professor Frommer here is the one who developed the language for Avatar, you know, the ones on Pandora, the Navi language. He's also developing the Martian language for a Disney film, John Carter, which is going to be released next year. But Professor Frommer is much more than someone who does amazing things in movies. So he was the professor emeritus for clinical management communication at USC's Marshall School of Business. He was the former director for Center of Management Communication. And before joining Marshall, he had taught and lived at Malaysia and Iran and spent 10 years in the business world as vice president and strategic planner in a Los Angeles corporation. Some of us might know him from USC classes. He has taught us advanced writing for business, cross-cultural business communication for non-native speakers. And there's much more to Professor Frommer than what I just told you in like 45 seconds. So please help me welcome Professor Frommer.
Some more. Good afternoon. I want to thank Dean Soni and Ben and the other students on the selection committee who invited me. And thank you all very much for coming. It's an honor and a privilege to be here. And I don't say that lightly. I'm no stranger to what matters to me and why. I started attending these talks soon after Rabbi Lemley created the series. Delighted to have you here today. And I was always impressed with the quality of the speakers and the passion and inspiration of their presentations. I also have to admit, I sometimes fantasized about what it would be like if I were to speak here, knowing, of course, that would never happen. The prospect seemed daunting, but also attractive in that it was a chance to talk about deeply personal things in a way I never did in the classroom. You see, when I was teaching at Marshall, I probably went overboard in not revealing my hand to my students. Not that I was in any way ashamed of who I was or what I believed, but since I taught writing and my assignments often asked students to take positions on controversial issues, I didn't want to get comments like, he only gave me a B because he was biased against me. So. Also, I guess I was sensitive to the charge you hear from some people on the right, that major universities are hotbeds of liberalism and atheism, and that professors like me are out to indoctrinate and corrupt our youth. So the chance to be open and honest in an accepting environment was more than a little appealing. And then in March of this year, I got a very unexpected and welcome email from Ben So, inviting me to take part in the program, which just may have had something to do with my newfound notoriety as a linguist who created the Na'vi language for James Cameron's Avatar. I've had occasion to speak about this on campus more than once, so forgive me if you've already heard how this came to pass. My brief biography is that I was an undergraduate, believe it or not, astrophysics, and then later math major, who went on to do graduate work in linguistics, getting a doctorate here at USC, and later, after years in the business world, wound up on the faculty of the Marshall School teaching management communication. And then 6 years ago, a bit before my 61st birthday, I received what I've come to refer to as the fateful email, a message from James Cameron's production company that had gone out to the linguistics department asking for a linguist who could develop an alien language for a science fiction film. At the time, we didn't know it was called Avatar. It was Project 880. The email was forwarded to me by my colleague, mentor, and friend, Ed Finnegan, who thought I might be interested. And boy, was I ever. I applied for the job and was fortunate enough to be chosen. And my life hasn't been the same since. I've met people I never thought I'd meet, worked with some of the most creative individuals on the planet, gotten an insider's look at the film industry, and received a level of recognition I never expected to get for anything. Perhaps the most amazing thing is that the Navi language I created has taken on a life of its own and is now being studied and used for genuine communication by a group of dedicated fans in something like 40 countries. But I'll say more about that later. When I got Ben's invitation, I wrote back saying how honored I felt, but I also asked if they were sure I would be appropriate, since I'm a non-standard kind of guy with non-mainstream beliefs and opinions. And Ben answered very graciously, reassuring me that I shouldn't hesitate to share my thoughts, even if they might be unexpected or controversial. So here I am. I'll just add that my purpose here today is to share ideas, not to sell them. If anyone finds my thoughts useful for reflection, I'll be pleased, but as they say, your mileage may vary. So, what matters to me? A lot of things, but three are at the top of my list. They may sound like cliches, but cliches often get that way because they express what people know to be true. The things that matter most to me are truth and honesty, beauty, and love. So let me talk about each of those in turn. In elementary school, I was the most ungraceful, uncoordinated, pudgy kid you ever saw. In choosing up teams for punch ball, do kids still play punch ball? I have no idea. We did back in New York. In choosing up teams for punch ball, the team captains would fight over me, not to get me on their team, but to avoid having me. But I was a very good student. I read a lot and I absorbed facts. I wanted to find out why things happened. And the facts and explanations that were presented to me I regarded as true. We didn't have the word nerd then, but that's pretty much what I was. On clear evenings, you could find me standing in a vacant lot with my star maps, tracing out the constellations. At the age of 10, I could reel off the names of the 20 brightest stars in order. I also discovered something interesting. Once I understood something, I invariably began to imagine how I would teach it to someone else. That eventually led to a career in teaching, which can still, on my best days, yield an almost physical thrill when I see the light dawn in a student's eyes. As I got older, however, my critical thinking apparatus began to kick in. And one question became more and more important. Just five simple words. How do you know that? It's a question that's continued to be very important to me. How do you know that? Why should I believe that what you're saying is in fact the truth? Are you being honest with me? It was a question of honesty that wound up molding my beliefs about many things, but in particular about religion. Like many Jewish kids growing up in New York, I was sent to Hebrew school at an early age. Most boys stopped at 13 after their bar mitzvah, but my parents wanted me to continue. So I went to Hebrew high school three times a week throughout my regular high school years. I don't regret that experience. For one thing, I learned a lot about another language, which developed into a lifelong love of languages. And for another, it gave me insight into my heritage and made me think about important things. My deeply religious phase lasted a year or two. I prayed every morning in the traditional way, with prayer shawl and phylacteries, going through the Orthodox service in Hebrew. Looking back on that now, what I remember more than anything else is a sense of security, of being, if you like, right with God. I had never felt that before and haven't felt it since. It was a benefit I can't deny. But as I got older, I began to have questions. How do we know we should be doing these things? My teachers had answers, usually because it's written in this holy book. But that only led me to more questions. How do we know that what's written there is true? How do we know that God said it? The answers I got didn't satisfy me. And that's when I first discovered something I continue to see today. In a lot of religious discourse, the level of honesty is not high. People say we know and we are certain, when clearly they don't know and couldn't possibly be certain. As for faith, by that time I had thrown my lot in with reason as a valid way of gaining understanding. And faith, which I took to be belief in the absence of compelling evidence, was something I couldn't achieve and in any event didn't want. It was also at that time that I began reading the Bible on my own, and not just the parts I had been encouraged to read. I found many things impressive and moving in a way that made me feel proud that my lineage had bequeathed these texts to the world. In the Hebrew Bible, swords into plowshares, concern for the widow and the orphan, the poetry of the Song of Songs, the wisdom of Ecclesiastes, the drama and anguish of Job. I didn't feel as close to the New Testament, but there too, I found some things that impressed me. Jesus saying, "What you do to the least of my brothers, you do to me." Paul's understanding that when you grow up, you need to put away childish things. But I also found other things in the Bible. On the descriptive level, absurd claims I could never believe. On the prescriptive level, things that saddened me, horrified me, grossly offended my sense of morality. So I came around to seeing the Bible as a quintessentially human document, written by ancient, fallible people who were seeking an understanding of God and their relationship to Him, some of whom rose above their time and some of whom did not. And so my attitude about the Bible in particular and sacred scripture in general came to be this: take the best and leave the rest. When I got to college, I discovered a book by the Princeton philosopher Walter Kaufman called The Faith of a Heretic, which had a major influence on my beliefs. In religion, as in most things, definitions are crucial. Depending on the definition of God, I began thinking of myself as a secular Jew who was either an agnostic or an atheist. If God is simply some kind of creative intelligence that brought the universe into existence, then I can call myself an agnostic, because I don't know whether or not such a being exists or has existed. But that's not the kind of God that interests people. The idea of God that's relevant to people's lives is, in Kaufman's phrase, the God of popular theism, if you like, the triple omni-God, simultaneously omniscient, omnipotent, and omnibenevolent. The God who has a whole world in his hands, who can control everything, who loves every human being and wants the best for each of us. I came to believe that such a God is wishful thinking. It's not necessary to go all the way to the Holocaust to reach that conclusion. Just take a look at a children's cancer ward. Kaufman's assertion seemed unassailable. The problem of suffering proves that the God of popular theism does not exist. And yet, while disconnecting myself from religion was in some ways liberating, I have to admit it came with a loss, which was the disconnection from tradition. Not everything that's old and traditional is good, but some of it is. Ritual and ceremony can add beauty and dignity to life. When my parents died, I went through the Orthodox Jewish ritual for mourning in their home because that's what they wanted. And even though I have no belief in the theism, I found that the customs and ceremonies of Judaism surrounding the death of a loved one were often meaningful and even comforting. For example, at the funeral, the close family members are called up to the front. The rabbi takes a razor blade and starts a cut in the lapel of your jacket, then rips your lapel vigorously so it hangs down torn and jagged. The tear in your clothes symbolizes the tear in your heart. I found that symbol. Very powerful. Maybe in time, secular traditions will develop that are equal in beauty and dignity and meaning to the best of the religious ones, but I don't think that's yet happened. Okay. That said, the most important thing about religion that I've discovered is that there's zero correlation between belief and goodness. Why is there still this widespread revulsion towards atheism? A big part, I think, is the feeling that without God, there's no reason not to murder and steal and rape and plunder. But that's belied by the facts. I've met wonderful believers and awful believers, moral atheists and rotten atheists. The fact is, you can be good with God and you can be good without God. When I gave up religion, my father wasn't pleased, but it was something that, if unwelcome, at least wasn't completely unexpected. I wasn't the first son to turn away from tradition, and he was able to come to terms with that. Later, though, I gave my parents something considerably more challenging to come to terms with. An important aspect of honesty is being honest with yourself, which hasn't always come easily to me. I was well into my 20s before I was able to admit to myself that I was gay. Prior to that, I explained my feelings to myself as a phase I was going through. I was a late bloomer. Eventually, I would burst forth in full glory as a raging heterosexual. I remember during my first week of college looking at the pictures in the Frosh directory and suddenly realizing I was concentrating much more on the pictures of the guys than the ones of the girls. But even then, that didn't make me think I was anything, it was anything more than a quirk. Years later, when I got back from the Peace Corps, it was finally time to face facts, which I did with the support of my only sibling, my brother, with whom I'm very close, and who is a very important part of my life, and who I learned at that time is also gay. For my parents, it wasn't easy. My father, in particular, had a very hard time and said some hurtful things. My mother internalized more, but suffered as well. This was a double bolt out of the blue for them, something totally beyond their ken. Their reasonable expectations of weddings and daughters-in-law and grandchildren were dashed. They must have thought they had raised a couple of Martians. Despite the fact that both his sons had PhDs, Dad would no longer talk about us with his peers. Perhaps the most telling thing was that once, when I was visiting, I noticed that the pictures of my brother and me that had been on the wall had been quietly taken down. In all this, however, my parents never stopped loving us, which is something I've come to appreciate more since they've been gone. I used to resent the fact that they weren't outspoken supporters of gay rights and didn't march in parades. Now I'm more able to put myself in their shoes and imagine what it must have been like for them. And I can feel the compassion for them that I wanted them to feel for me. As an out gay man, I've been extraordinarily lucky. lucky to have lived in places where I've encountered little ill will. Lucky to have worked in organizations like USC and very much like the film industry where I could be myself and feel accepted. Lucky above all else to have met my life partner, now my husband, early on. Others haven't been as fortunate. We GLBT people have made considerable advances, but when I hear about gay kids who are bullied to the point that they sometimes take their own lives, I'm filled with rage. Such things matter to me a lot. Okay. Something else that matters to me, as I mentioned, is beauty. The world is full of beauty and also of ugliness. Which one you attempt to maximize in your life has a large impact, I think, on your outlook. I found a number of reliable sources of beauty. There's intellectual beauty, the beauty of an elegant mathematical proof, the way a single principle, natural selection, explains virtually everything we see in the living world, the workings of natural languages, and sometimes even of artificial ones. And of course, there's art in the wide sense. When it comes to visual art, I'm hopeless. I'm woefully undeveloped. But music is another story. One of the things I'm most grateful to my parents for is the fact that they started me out on piano at a very young age. I began with local teachers and kept up my piano studies throughout high school and college. During my high school years in New York, through a series of improbable events, I wound up as a student of a world-class piano teacher, Jeanette Hain, the most inspiring teacher I ever had. I was hardly her star pupil. I think I was the only one who wasn't aiming at a professional career in music. Those of you who know classical music, you're probably familiar with the name of a pianist, Murray Pariah. He's considered possibly the greatest pianist of his generation. Okay, he had his lesson right before I had mine. The standards she held up to me were invaluable. To this day, I try to keep up my piano technique, and I derive a lot of pleasure from making music, either by myself or with others. I can't always do at the piano what I'd like to, but I know what's good, and that's important to me. You know, some people say human beings can't achieve perfection, but that's not true. While there are no perfect people, there are perfect works of art. Many Bach fugues and Mozart piano concertos and Beethoven quartets are perfect in any meaningful sense of the word. If you learn to appreciate and love great art, whether it's painting or music or drama or poetry, you'll have a reliable source of deep, rich pleasure in your life that you can turn to at will. People can let you down. Your body can betray you, but Bach is always Bach. Mozart is always Mozart in all their perfection and beauty. They won't let you down. It's tragic to me that young people today are less exposed than ever to great music. What a loss. The other source of beauty in my life that I wanted to mention is the natural world. John and I live in a hill community just north of downtown. Even though we're only 15 minutes away by car from City Hall, we get plenty of animals passing through. Skunks, possums, raccoons, squirrels, the occasional coyote, and birds. We recently set up a simple bird bath on the back deck, and we're currently getting dozens of beautiful little gray and yellow warblers who drink and cavort around in the water and entertain us endlessly. We could watch them for hours. With beliefs like mine, I don't know if I count as a spiritual person. I'm not even sure what that means. But I can tell you that on rare occasions, watching our wild birds and animals, or in the past playing with our three miniature schnauzers, I felt a mysterious connection to all of them as if we're part of the same web of life. The feeling doesn't last, but it's quite wonderful while it's there. And that brings us to the third big thing that matters to me, which is love. I can think of little more important in life than being able to love and receive love in an intimate relationship. I accepted myself as a gay man in 1968, and the following year I met my life partner, John Brinkley. Just this week we celebrated our 42nd anniversary of being together, 40 of those years at the same address. I'm not sure if that's a sign of stability or inertia. And at the same time, our third anniversary as a married couple. We got married in 2008, during the window that opened up here for several months before Proposition 8 was passed. So we're one of the 18,000 gay couples whose marriage is officially recognized by the state of California. We had a simple ceremony at home the last Thursday of October, 2008. The election in which Prop 8 figured was the following Tuesday. On the Saturday in between, there was a home football game. Now, this is a terrible confession, but up to that point, I had never been to a football game, ever. A colleague of mine found that out and told me, "You are not leaving USC without attending a home game." So that Saturday, we went together. I had never been on campus on game day. It was, to say the least, an eye-opening experience, and mostly a very pleasant one, but not entirely. When I emerged from the parking structure, there on the corner of Flower and Exposition were about 40 or 50 mostly young people with signs urging a yes vote on Prop 8 to protect our families. And on campus, there were similar groups of students. I was proudly wearing my two-day-old wedding ring, so I went up to several of the young people on the corner, showed it to them, and explained I had just married my male partner. And the young man smiled and said, "Congratulations." I then asked them why they thought I was a threat to their marriages, and they couldn't tell me. Please don't understand, I'm not in any way saying these people didn't have the right to demonstrate and express their feelings. Of course they did. This is America. But how sad that they felt the need to devote time and energy to make sure marriage wouldn't be available to people like me. How, I wonder, does letting me into their club devalue their membership? I've read endless debates on same-sex marriage, seen video after video. From my perspective, all the arguments against it are easily answered, except one. God doesn't like it, and it says so right here. To me, when scripture is used to deny people's humanity based on outmoded moral codes, we all lose. Let me end on a positive note. None of what I've said is particularly unique or groundbreaking, but it helps define me as a human being. And we human beings are the best things and the worst that the universe has produced. Our capacity for good is infinite, as is our capacity for evil. At our best, there's nothing we can't do. And at our worst, there's nothing we can't do. Since I don't believe in an afterlife, for me, this life is supremely important. And if we're going to maintain a life here on Earth without destroying each other or the planet, we have to maximize the good. That implies overcoming the tribalism that's haunted our history. We can't continue to see our loyalty group as our immediate family or our neighbors or our village or our country or our ethnic or racial or sexual group or our co-religionists. We need to think of our loyalty group as all of humanity. We need to build communities that transcend the classic boundaries. We need to come together because all we have is each other. And that brings me full circle to Avatar and Na'vi. The most unexpected thing in my Avatar experience has been the growth of the Na'vi language community. As I mentioned, there are dedicated fans all over the world who are not just learning a couple of words as a lark, but are mastering the vocabulary and sometimes complicated grammar and using the language for real communication. There are fans from different countries without a fluent natural language in common who speak and write to each other in Na'vi. Some in the community use a language considerably better than I do. And they're helping me develop it further by suggesting new vocabulary and structures for me to consider and approve. To my knowledge, that's never happened before. The Na'vi community is a diverse one. It skews young, although there are people my age as well. Some members are so sophisticated, they're virtually doctorate level in linguistics. Others have never encountered a foreign language before. We have males and females, believers, non-believers, gays and straights, different cultures and backgrounds. The atmosphere is remarkably supportive, non-judgmental, and non-competitive. A place where real friendships are made. And what brought these folks together is a common interest in the language I constructed. Through it, they're bridging their differences. That's something I can feel proud of. Something that, along with truth and honesty and beauty and love, matters to me a great deal. Thank you. Now, I think we have some time for questions, so, yes, sir. Okay.
Yeah, thank you for coming, first off. Your life revolves around communication, even from the outside to the end. And I was wondering what your opinions and thoughts are on the future of communication and how communication sort of in this zeitgeist really revolves around sort of streamlined and superficial communication via text message, email, Facebook, what have you. So I was just wondering what your thoughts were on where you see the future of communication going. Do you think we're losing a sense of humanity the more we, you know, use technology as a conduit for communication?
Yeah, I think you need to, thank you for that question. I think you need to distinguish between the medium and the message, or if you like, the conduit for communication and the content of communication. The new stuff we're seeing is a new means of communication, but in that you can express virtually whatever you like. So basically, I see it as much more of a positive than anything else. I mean, some people seem hung up on the fact that, you know, people are texting like crazy, and rather than writing Y-O-U, they're writing the letter U, and rather than writing A-R-E, they're writing the letter R. That's kind of silly. What, you know, people use shortcuts. They've been using shortcuts all the time. So the medium, I think, is conducive to lots of different things. One thing, as I'm thinking about it, that I realize may be a problem is the Twitter phenomenon, in that you're trying to get a message across in 140 characters. You know, and you can't always do that. And by putting people into that kind of box, it tends to trivialize communication. So I think that is something that needs to be taken into account. But for example, I take part in several online forums, and I see an incredible range of sophistication and depth just by people posting to forums. There are people who are obviously young and immature and kind of silly and extremely superficial. And there are people with extraordinary opinions and ideas and depth who are posting to the same forums. So long story short, I have hope for the future. Yeah. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
Hi. I'm a PhD student in psycholinguistics.
Wow.
And I'm expect to graduate next year. So I was very curious about your transition from a linguistic PhD work in the business area.
Uh-huh.
Can you tell us something more about your transition, you know, during that period?
Sure.
Thanks.
I completed my doctorate here at USC in 1981. I wrote it on an aspect of Persian grammar. I had lived in Iran, spent an incredible year in Iran in the middle 70s. And when I came back to the States, I switched my dissertation topic, found something in Persian grammar, and completed it. And at that point, for various reasons, I decided I didn't want an academic career after all. For one thing, there weren't that many positions open. And John and I had established a home in Los Angeles. I wasn't willing to kind of pull up stakes and go elsewhere. So I decided to see what the business world might be like, having zero background in the area. So I began to look at the ads in the paper, actually landed a few interviews, and the first thing I was asked was, how much accounting have you had? And I said, well, they said, you know what, why don't you go and take some accounting courses? So that's what I did. I enrolled in a community college and then at UCLA, had a year of accounting. Eventually, after floundering around for a while, I found my way to a very bizarre company in Marina Del Rey, which for whatever reason liked my background. And I stayed there for 10 years. And I became a strategic planner and a business writer and a vice president. So I gained some business experience. And that company went belly up in 1994. And as I mentioned to Varun earlier, it was a proverbial blessing in disguise because it gave me the impetus, I have another image in my mind, to get out there and find something that I really wanted. And I realized what I really wanted was to come back to the university. So I discovered, to my great delight, there was something called business communication. I figured, well, I have the business, 10 years, and linguistics sure sounds like communication. So I put it together and I convinced the, at that time, chair of the department, Doug Andrews, that I knew something about business communication, and I was hired by the Marshall School. And it was a wonderful time in a very congenial, wonderful school and department. So that's kind of how I got there. I've kept my hand in linguistics. Prior to Avatar, I'm co-author of a linguistics workbook with Ed Finnegan called Looking at Languages. So I've kind of kept up with that, but Avatar was a big change in my career. Thank you. Hi.
You mentioned that you appreciate your parents more after they passed. How? Why?
Why did I appreciate my parents more after their passed? Well, you know, I guess the easy answer to that is sometimes you don't know what you've lost until it's gone. I had a close relationship with my parents, especially with my mother. And things were a little more distant between me and my father, but that was pretty much always the case. Both parents died at home in New York. They both died of cancer in a hospice situation. Difficult situation. My mother wound up living another 10 years after Dad died, and that was a chance for us to get even closer. We had an incredible trip to Israel. It was my mom's fourth and my first. I think it was back in 97 or 98, just the two of us going around the country. I was quite close to my mother, but sort of inevitably you begin to see things differently, I think, when they're not there. I don't know if that's about the best I can say right now for that. Yeah. Hi.
I study linguistic anthropology.
Hey, great.
Hi. I was wondering what examples could you give us within the Navi language that shows something about their culture? So expressions or maybe the grammatical structure. Mm-hmm. Like how does their language influence their worldview?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Language cannot exist apart from culture. So every culture influences the language. Okay. Of course, what I learned about the Navi culture, about life on Pandora, I got from the movie, and I got from the script, and I got from James Cameron. There are a number of things. This is not exactly culture, but physiology influenced the language as well. For example, the Navi have four fingers on each hand, not five. And so therefore, I said to myself, you know, they probably don't have a decimal system. They probably have an octal system. And so I ran that by James Cameron, and he said, absolutely. So in Navi, you count, au, mune, pe, ting, mr, pukap, kine, vol, which is 1 to 8. And then 9 is volau, 8 and 1. And 10 is vol, mune. Okay, that's one thing. Certain concepts are important to the Navi. My favorite word in the whole language is mewauni aea. It has all these vowels that sort of glide from one to the other. I came up with the word before I had a meaning for it, but when I decided that the meaning would express a concept that's very important and beautiful in their culture, which is the balance of life, feeling at one with the planet and with nature. There are some proverbs in Na'vi that reflect life on the planet. There's a proverb that goes, "Etzes emikun kopulte," and what that means is, the tail and the ears also speak. Now, what would that mean? Well, if you saw the movie, you know that the Na'vi are extremely expressive, and you can sometimes tell what's going on with them emotionally by looking at their ears and looking at what's happening with the tail. So that what it's saying is, don't just listen to the words. Body language can tell you something, too. So there are some other things to it that have to do with culture. Thank you. Anything else?
Hi, I want to thank you for such a intensely personal and introspective talk. It was really moving, and I appreciate you being so open with us. I wondered if you could share with us what you think the best way to be a straight ally would be for the community here at USC or more broadly in LA.
Wow, that's a wonderful question. You know, we can't do it without straight allies. I think, there are several things that occur to me. One is that, you know, if you hear someone talking smack or telling jokes or using language that's not appropriate, it's very helpful to say, you know, I'm not gay, but when I hear that, it really bothers me because I know gay people, and I know that that kind of language hurts them. That's one thing. Supporting gay organizations with your donations is extremely, extremely positive. And when things come up for votes, because they will, you know, I have no doubt that gay marriage will be back on the ballot. I have great hopes because the future of that decision is in your hands, not mine, and that's a very good thing. If you look at the demographics, you find that the young people are overwhelmingly in favor and say, what's the big deal? Okay, it's people my age that are the problem. So eventually, you guys are going to dominate, and that's a very good thing. So when it's time for these things to vote, and when there's public discussion and public discourse on these things, for people to use your voices, to use your votes, and to use your voices to support the good fight is very useful. So just a few little things. One of the most pernicious things, I wish there was something we could do about it, is the way the word gay among very young people seems to have evolved into a word for bad. Oh, that's okay. You know, gotta squash that. That's a bad thing, and that really creates a bad atmosphere for a lot of people. Anything else? Sir? Can I give you the scoop on Avatar 2 and 3? Boy, do I wish I could. I can tell you, and it's not that I'm holding back, it's I don't know any more about it than you do. The public knows, the public has been told it's coming out, 2 is coming out in 2014, 3 is coming out in 2015. They will be shot together. And the only thing Jim Cameron has led on about it is that they will involve water to a very great degree, whether it's in the ocean or under the ocean or what, we don't know. I have my fingers crossed that I will be asked back to work on those movies, but nothing yet. So keep you posted. Okay. Anything else? Thank you all very much. Appreciate it.
Please join me again in thanking Professor Paul Frommer for really an extraordinary presentation. Thank you.